I mean, I've been here for quite some time now, and there are so many people around, and you know what? They keep on talking about ECD.
Ah, ECD, I know.
Wait.
I know what ECD is.
Wait a second, you're kidding. I mean, of course I knew you. Now you see, I see you. You're a professor at the Saarland for evaluation, being involved in evaluation, developing evaluation, and you're director of Center of Evaluation. So, so you must know, and is that right? So what is it? Is it like electronic capacity device?
No. It's electronic car development. You know, before, this cars running my...
But are you sure?
No.
These people don't have cars with them. I don't know.
Of course I'm kidding.
Oh, you are.
Yeah, of course.
So what is it then?
It has to do with evaluation. You have heard
what?
Evaluation.
Evolution?
It's about evaluation. You're just doing assessments, you know. You collect data, and then you make an assessment, and then you tell the people what to do. You get recommendations.
And that sounds cool, and all these people do that?
I don't know.
We ask them later, right?
I have no idea why they are here. Maybe they're waiting for the food and for the drinks. Yeah, but you know, that's about evaluation, and ECD is evaluation capacity development. You know, there's so many governments and organizations, they want to use that instrument of evaluation nowadays, and it's very popular. You know, if you are a modern organization, you have to use it. And then, yeah, the question is where all these qualified people come from. You know, you must have some qualifications for doing evaluation, of course. It should be a profession.
It's not a profession?
They try to be a profession. But it's not a good one, you know? It depends on what you think, what is part of the profession, what characterizes a profession, yeah? So,
a car mechanic.
For example, yeah. He has a training, a Krapp training, and of course, at the end, he gets a certificate. And it's not like with the evaluators, it's like with a journalist, you know? Also, a journalist, if you have written an article, you can tell yourself, and it's published, of course. Yeah, you wrote an article and it's published, and you can tell yourself that you are a journalist. And similar with us. So if we have figured out something which we say it's an evaluation, we can say we are evaluators. And that's the problem with the evaluation capacity development. You know, there are a lot of courses now offered. So, yeah.
I think they participate in a course too.
Yeah, but I know I have heard about IPDET. I must say that is a very useful course because they have so excellent teachers. But you know, there are a lot of other courses. It's like these cooking book style courses. So you go in such a cooking course, yeah? And afterwards you think you are a good cook, and you are able to cook. And mostly it's not like that.
It's a recipe, right? I do that.
I made a lot of bad experiences about
that. Cooking?
No, not with cooking. With people who visited the cooking course and then think they can cook. And this is similar with evaluation. They visit them a few days of course, and then afterwards they think they are evaluators. But as I said, there are different kinds of courses, and that of course is something very different because it's about 2 weeks courses and a core course, advanced courses. So I think the people learn really something about evaluation, and that is, as I said, is very important because there is a great need for high qualified evaluators. And if there are not enough qualified evaluators, then evaluation maybe gets a bad image because then we don't fit the needs of our clients, or we produce not the quality they expect. And then there is a risk that they say, well, now I decided to do an evaluation, to spend money for an evaluation, but the result out of it is really disappointing. So to some people I told a story today that I think you attended the conference too, Shetty, in Peru, where the health minister in former times was an evaluator. And we were sitting there, and this guy was giving the keynote speech, now health minister. So what people expected, oh, he was an evaluator before, and now he will praise evaluation and that he will use evaluation for his work. And he disappointed us completely, because he said, well, you're expecting this because I was in former times an evaluator, but I must tell you, I never use evaluation for my work. And we all were disappointed, and he said, why? It is because they are never on time, this is so complicated to read, you never know what they want, they give recommendations I can't follow, and so on and so on. And actually, I must say, for some evaluation reports, it's like that. And that is why evaluation capacity development is so important.
And probably not only for evaluators, but then obviously for the ones who are supposed to use them.
Yeah, I think so. I think it is also important not only for the people conducting evaluations, of course they must know their business, but to get money for evaluation, I think it is also very much important to convince the people on higher position levels to give money for evaluation, and they only will do it if they are convinced that they can use the results for their decision making. And so that's important.
Do you think they should participate in it too?
Oh, I think so. And I know there is an excellent course about upper and middle management. So, I don't know. But I've heard about it. Yeah, okay, let's see. Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Any more questions?
Well, no, really, really, really interesting.
I know, I have to answer. Yeah, I have to ask you a question.
Yeah, I think I can tell some interesting stories.
Yeah, I know, because I know right now that I was a program manager, right? Program manager? Head of IPDET? I don't know. But she has, you know, she has a special power. But before she had also a life before it, and
before retirement.
You can trust me, that's true. And I wouldn't say that. Some years ago, we were working together, so she
until March, you worked together.
Until March. No, I mean long before that. She was also working with the Center for Evaluation and Supporting, okay? But then she was the head of the department, which was also responsible for evaluation capacity development. And that's why I would like to ask you what have been your experiences with evaluation capacity development. I have heard that also in your organization, the EVA, the German Evaluation Institute, it was not really of high priority to do that.
Yeah, quite interesting, right? You have an evaluation institute, and you would expect that just automatically everybody would understand, yeah, whoever is doing evaluation should invest in evaluation capacity development also. But it was quite hard actually to convince the ministry, say, look, we are an evaluation institute, an independent evaluation institute, and we will do evaluations. But at the same time, it's so important to be when you work in a country, and you think about how can you develop capacities within this country on different levels, different target groups, so that actually people are more and more able to do their own evaluations. And not only do evaluations, but when it comes to a more systems level, then what is needed in a country on evaluation capacities, not only on the individual side, but also on the institutional and societal level. So that was quite interesting to see the reactions. But then, as we started, and we really pushed it through, and we started working on it very hard, so the more they could see how the impact was of what we did together with the partners, the more convinced they were. And now I think it has quite a high standard in within the German Development Corporation.
That's very interesting. You see, that also has to do with awareness building. Actually, in the evaluation institute, that evaluation capacity development is is really an important task, and it's even more important if you have a look at developing countries where they get their first experiences with evaluation. So how big it out in Costa Rica, where you have been for several years?
And we had the chance, actually, that was really one chance in your lifetime, I guess, to implement a pure ECD project, right? We did ECD all over. And the conditions were really, really good, because in Costa Rica already since 1995, they have a master evaluation implemented. So already quite good capacities, and the awareness was there. And we started with further trainings for different target groups. But then it became quite clear very soon that the training itself is not sufficient. Now, we have a very, very good relationship with different organizations within Costa Rica. So that started with the government, but also we work together with NGOs and with the universities and with evaluation associations. So we formed a national platform where we all sat together. And I think that this is quite unique. We have the chance to work in one country, the awareness is there, so that was also really, really nice. You know, when I went to Costa Rica, and then I was always so happy, I said, no, we don't have to convince anybody about evaluation capacity development. Everybody knew what we were talking about. So it was kind of depressing to go back to Germany, where you have to convince still people, and they're really kind of hesitant. So that was really cool and fun to work there, especially with this platform. And now they are, because that's the sad point, I'm not working there anymore. But they are developing now a regional platform where more and more actors from Latin America are coming in. And but this platform really changed a lot, because for the first time, the main actors would sit at one table and would talk to each other about evaluation and how the country could proceed, and the awareness of the people that they need to work together in order to get the best out of it really, really raised and changed a lot. So imagine you sit with the minister or vice minister in Costa Rica. I mean, Costa Rica is small, right? But very nice. And still you can talk to ministers directly. So they are involved, and then you have NGOs, smaller ones, bigger ones, you have representatives from the associations, universities, and so on. So we actually could develop together a theory of change. Can you imagine? That was hard. But it was really, really worth it. So together we developed this theory of change, and together we decided what action should be taken in order to reach the different outcomes of this project. And you were there too, I mean, you experienced it.
Just a few weeks ago, I went there. It's always worth to visit Costa Rica, I can recommend it to you. Especially if you want to learn something about how to implement the monitoring and evaluation system on a national level. I think what was special with that kind of actions there was that many different actors work in the same direction. So we have had this, it was so-called a fossilized project, which was sponsored by the German government, an ECD project. And beside that, we implemented that also a university cooperation. And this is, I think, a wonderful combination, because we mentioned that topic several times before, to bring the youth into the evaluation. And of course, they are very well trained people graduating from a master course in Costa Rica, but having only little chances to practice evaluation. And so during this university cooperation, one of our objectives was to conduct together with young students and master graduates an evaluation. And out of that, we got a lot of experience, which we are using now for a second round, together with Fossilal and with EWAL partners, to bring in the young people into practice. And this is, I think, is also something you can recommend if you want to establish evaluation capacity in your country. I think it is a good idea to cooperate with universities there, are a lot of young, motivated people with creative ideas, and they're very cheap.
And this example shows also that you have a very good training offer for years, and but then still applying evaluation was somehow missing. So people are eager to get into business to do evaluation. So from the, what want to be established as consultants, but also at the same time within the organizations. And here it comes to the second part. We should talk about the institutionalization of evaluation, right? So within the ministries, within different public administrative organizations, but also within NGOs, they are quite interested in, okay, how can we actually institutionalize evaluation so that it's not a one-shot thing, right? And that was another really, really, really rich experience. Where you sit together and think, okay, yeah, you have to do capacity development on individual level also within an organization. Like, for example, if it's a management training for institutions and public administration. And then, for example, for some NGOs, we did together a participatory evaluation in a very remote area of Costa Rica, where we worked very, very closely together with people involved in the health community system. And from there, we could disseminate not only the results, but the lesson learned from these processes. So that was also quite an interesting experience to have on individual level capacities developed. Now they can apply these capacities within the institutions. They develop the different capacities necessary to commission, to do evaluation partly, and to use, of course, evaluation. And then we, not only that, we work together with the Latin American Association of Evaluation, ELAC. You probably heard about them. It's a famous evaluation association. And we develop together evaluation standards. So that's also something important which you can then include in your work in the different institutions and to have a framework built up. So that all kind of, you know, linked up together, which was very, very interesting.
I think you see with these examples that evaluation capacity development is not just about training. If you talk about that in a country or in an organization, there are a lot of different dimensions. Of course, for example, you have to establish some structures and some processes to anchor evaluation or monitoring and evaluation in a company or in a country. And for that, the people need very different qualifications on the different levels or positions where they work. So for example, some people have to be able to write an evaluation policy or to know, okay, if I want to establish a monitoring and evaluation system in my organization, how can I do that? Which steps do I have to follow? What are the lessons learned out of similar activities? And for that, I think we need also different formats for the evaluation capacity. And it was actually a little bit funny thing, because we started in Costa Rica with operational courses on the operational level. So it was a 3 weeks course, 3 times 1 week. And then after the course, the people said, well, now we know, actually we know now how an evaluation should be conducted. But we are sorry, we are not the ones who decide about it. I said, that's right. We have to climb up the ladder a little bit, and that was the idea. It comes up with the evaluation course for upper and middle management. It's only a 3 days course, and part of it is to build awareness for the topic of evaluation, but also to give them some insights how they can use evaluation for their work, and of course then how they can commission an evaluation, to know how to ask evaluation questions, terms of references, and to find the right budget according to their questions. This is why it's very difficult for many people that they balance the questions they have, the evaluation questions, that they balance it with the money they have. And my experience is, especially in Costa Rica, as more the people are motivated, as more questions than they have. They say, oh, we are now convinced to do evaluation, let us do it, and then they have a bundle of evaluation questions, and then mostly you have disappointed people a little bit, because then you have to ask for the financing, say, oh, how much money do you have? And then they say the amount, they say, okay, with this amount you can't answer 100 questions, you have to focus on the most important ones, and to bring this in the balance is something you should also learn in this middle and upper management course. But the funny thing was, again, after the 3 days course, the people talked to us and said, well, actually, we understand now how we can use evaluation for our work, but we are not the ones who decide. And so we went a step further and said, okay, that's true, so we must have a format for the top decision makers. And they have not really much time, so this is only a course for, let's say, 2 or 3 hours. Mostly combine it with a nice event, having a breakfast together or an evening dinner, and then we transport our message to build awareness for evaluation, yeah, and to make them interested. And in Costa Rica it was really perfect. I never had the chance to talk to the complete cabinet of a country. And that happened in Costa Rica with the president and all ministers, to talk with them, of course only 20 minutes, but to talk with them about evaluation and how to implement a monitoring and evaluation system in their country. And I must say that it is also a funny thing that a guy from Germany is telling the Costa Ricans how they should implement the monitoring and evaluation system on a national basis, and we in Germany are far away from that. And nobody is listening on the political level. Nobody is listening to me. So it's really funny.
But Reinhard, it sounds like Costa Rica is paradise for evaluators. So is it really that great? Is it? Are there any problems? Nothing?
I don't think so. No, of course. Everywhere there are problems. So Costa Rica is a wonderful country. But, of course, there is a big fluctuation in the government. As you know, there have been new elections, and then the government is complete, they exchange the people completely. So you have to start with this awareness building again. Yeah? And it's a little bit, it's not the same in the ministries. A lot of the people on the upper and middle management level, they stay. But, of course, the ministers and secretary of state are exchanged. But what makes me hopefully is that this is really sustainable, is that they started to create this national evaluation plan, where they decide which programs they will evaluate, and now they combine it also with the SDGs, and say we will evaluate programs which are connected with the SDGs, and that was their idea to do that. So I think I think it could be really a success story, even if there are also some risks, because the main point is always the money. They would like to do it, and I think they have an idea for what they are doing, and they, but in the moment I do not see very clearly if they really use the evaluation results then for really changing the policy. But there are also some signs, some indicators that this could happen. But the main thing will be, and that's actually the proof of the pudding, you can say, okay, I'm so in favor for evaluation, and you do it, and you have an evaluation policy, but at the end, it always comes to money. And then, if it is, this all is only rhetoric, the people say it because they think they have to say it, no, at the end, they have to give money for it. And they will only give money for it permanently if they will take use out of evaluations. And this comes again then to evaluation capacity development, because it is our responsibility of all the people sitting here, it's our responsibility that we do not disappoint the people who decided to use evaluation for their policy, and that they do not come to the result of the decision, well, I spent money for that and they don't give me the proper answer, I can't use these results. And then could something happen, what happened two decades ago, evaluation, there was no boom in that. We have had the first boom in the 60s and the 70s, in the 80s and the 90s, evaluation was declining, and now we have the second new boom. But there is no guarantee that this boom will continue, and it's our responsibility that this boom will continue. We have really to do a lot not to disappoint the ones who spend money for evaluation. That's our responsibility.
So it actually really makes sense that if that exists and that we are all here and that we are going to develop it that further. Is there anything you would say we could learn from this experience? I mean, what really comes to my mind is immediately is like, because we implemented in Costa Rica, you mentioned it this morning, the blended learning program in Costa Rica, and it would start in Ecuador and implemented it in Uganda. So that idea occurred to me that it would make sense to integrate it to IPDET. So that for if we could use some different formats, online formats, and then combine it with presence times in here. We could also work together with different centers in partnership in different parts of the world, because obviously we can learn a lot from each other. And it's not that we are, I mean, you made your evaluation professors, but it's not that we know everything, and we, of course, we don't have all the experiences. So what do you think about that, and what else could we learn from these experiences for IPDET?
I think we also can learn a lot for IPDET. So I think we need more different formats for different target groups, because as I said, we cannot only focus on the ones who should conduct evaluation and who need these in-depth courses, knowing how to develop a design, how to use mixed methods approaches and all that. This is more for the people conducting evaluations. But as I said, for the development of evaluation in a country, it is very important to convince the management and also the top management, the ministers in the government, and not forget also the civil society organizations. So that was also a very interesting experience in Costa Rica, that there the civil society is very much interested in evaluation. Also, if you look at the European countries, there's not much interest in the civil society about the results of evaluation, and less in participating in the evaluations. And so that is true, so that we can learn from especially from countries in the south, and especially in the field of the participation of the civil society. I think we have to look very carefully what's developing, for example, in Latin America, also in other countries, which I don't know what's going on there in the civil participation in evaluation, but that we can learn there how they do it. And of course, other formats then will be necessary. So for example, one we did with the civil society, with communities in the health sector in Costa Rica, doing a self-evaluation. You need other competencies and qualifications as an evaluator if you want to consult such kinds of people or such kinds of evaluation as with our traditional evaluation concept. And that means we have to integrate different approaches, and we have to focus also on different target groups if you want to establish monitoring and evaluation in the country. And the other thing is with the certification topic. I think it's a good idea to connect IPDET programs with master programs, so that at the end you are able also to get you have the chance to get a master degree. As you know, there's also a big discussion in our professional communities and associations about certification. And the Canadian Association, they presented one solution, and in Britain they have a solution, but I'm a professor at the university, and I believe in academic certificates. And I think in the future, these academic certificates will play a major role in the professionalization of evaluation.